Thank you. I hope she has said something good about me, because when I understand French, I'm very honored. I just heard I'm the first Chinese architect to be invited to give a speech here. So I'm very happy and honored. And good evening. Before I start my speech, I think I want to show a little video. Marina says the most of you don't know about China that much. So whatever I said, you have to trust me. Huh? What I do is I will talk about China first, and then I explain why I do design the way I do. And first of all, I'm not a professional architect. I'm amateur architect because I teach in the university, and I'm a one guy's studio. So which means I do design all by myself, and the student will help me with the drawings, and that's it. So I don't have much project to show, but I have some ideas to share with you. Everybody knows that we have different perspectives, different views about how we see the world, right? The spider will see the world like he will set up a net and then wait for his chance to come. And his world is very small. And the eagle's view is much more wider because he flies very high. So he could see the world like this, yeah, because he has bigger vision. And if we describe this boat, different people will describe it a different way. Like the guy who is an expert of material, we talk about why this one is in timber, why in carbon fiber or whatever material. And the designer will talk about the shape properly, right? But we can also see this boat from another way. How this boat brings us experience through this, and through this, and through here. Then we see world differently. We are all familiar with the shape, a globe. But we very seldomly challenge why the Earth took the shape of a globe. And why the globe of Earth is the same shape like a grip is a very Zen question. Huh? We never ask questions like this. But if we try to understand fundamental reasons why these two different, totally different things share the same shape, we probably will understand the world differently. Okay, the reason is very simple. The largest volume, smallest surface. So it's easier to protect the content of the globe, right? So that's why nature the shape. And then we can understand easily also why the sleeves take shape of a surface, because maximize the efficiency of getting energy from the sun. And then I just showed the video. I don't know who did the video, because I checked up the website and somebody did this video. It's my project. It's after my project is finished, of course. But the reason why I show the video is try to show a different way of understanding how we do perspectives. This is, everyone knows, by Frank Lloyd Wright. But not everyone knows, Frank Lloyd Wright was the first modern architect or Western architects who used bird's eye view perspective to represent his architecture in relationship to environment. And this is very interesting, because before him, Western people look at the world from a human eyesight. Yeah, you have a subject and you have an object, and the subject look at object through perspectives like this. We see the world from a cosmological point of view. Bird's eye view is the way we project our relationship to architecture, to our environment. It's all like this, because we never separate what is subject, what is object. The question is, we see the world differently, but why we built the same way? So this is the question mark I want to try to challenge. And of course, now we do this, the representation through videos, through whatever program you use, SketchUp, whatever. So you can see the building before you build in any perspective, right? And it's not clear, huh? But this is this long scroll. So because we use multiple vanishing point, and also because we look at the world from the cosmological point of view, so we can actually open up a picture, an image. It's like a movie. This is from Song Dynasty, almost like 1,000 years ago. This is a Chinese garden. And interesting about Chinese garden is we have a lot of things inside, right? We have pavilion, we have corridor, we have rocks, we have water, we have trees, and so on and so forth. So this is a Chinese character. Here is the boundary. Here is the earth, and here's water, here's the tree. So the Chinese character, you can understand how the meaning of the words has come from. And important thing is this corridor. So we always try to elongate the process. So when you want to experience a Chinese garden, it has to be a long process. But on the other side of the Strait of the Sea, we have a Japanese garden, which is mostly at a fixed point, you enjoy a view. The reason behind this is because the Chinese landscape is like this. It's a very typical Chinese mountain. It's called a Yellow Mountain. In this Yellow Mountain, actually, daytime, on the different seasons, you experience different thing. From far, afar, from close distance, you see different thing. So you have to go through the mountain, through a process, to experience this mountain. But in Japan, the landscape is like this. You know, Fuji Mountain is a very typical Japanese mountain. There are volcanoes. Volcanoes always look like this. From afar, close distance, they look the same, right? So this is a part of the reason that landscape inspired human beings to design our human environment in a different way. When we look at China, in terms of time, long time ago, it's a beautiful culture. No problem with that. This is from Song Dynasty, 1,000 years ago. So we cut any piece, small piece, it's a complete image. It's because we use multiple vanishing points, not perspective. And looking at China from afar in terms of space, China now tried to present itself like this. It's like a zoo of buildings. But when we look at China in close distance, China looks like this. Because the rapid urbanization process, we don't have the time to be reflexive about the problems we're having along the way of urbanization. And we used to build like this, very sensitive. You have to choose the right time, right place, and to do the right work. But this is the current condition in China. And his name is Liang Qichao, is a very important contemporary Chinese a professor from Tsinghua, where I teach now. He was the first Chinese who realized that China is simply another culture. So before him, every Chinese believed we are the center of the world. So we call it itself Middle or Center Kingdom, right? Middle Kingdom. He went to Japan to study in Japan. From Japan, he looked at China. He understand somehow, okay, China is simply another culture. He tried to reform when he came back to China, but he failed, of course. And the second chance we got in China is Mao's time. Mao tried to reform, to build a new China. But somehow under this new regime, you have to be really conscious about ideological ideas. This color is magical. If you want to do landscape painting, you must have this magical color. Is there a laser pointer? No, never mind. So this is, you have to got this. Otherwise, it's illegal, all right? And so in the 70s, 60s, people understand China as Mao's China. He was the only individual who can be a poet, who can be a philosopher, a thinker, everything. And then, of course, after the chaos of Cultural Revolution, in the end of 70s, when Cultural Revolution finished, China is like this, very tired, like old person who is sick, and try to recover. In 1979, this painting was exhibited in the National Gallery in Beijing, and everyone look at the image was shocked, because the real size of this picture is about 1.8 meter by 1.5. So it's 10 times larger than real size of a human being, right? No hidden whatsoever. It's tried to enlarge the reality 10 times more. And people were shocked when they saw this image. Because you are not allowed to show reality in the 60s, in the 70s. So when we see those kind of image, it's really something different. And then in the 60s, 70s, after that, after the Cultural Revolution in the 80s, something very subtle changed. So we didn't know which way to go. And political agenda is not really clear. And then we have started having TV, but there's no program. And then our landscape, urban landscape, everyone knows is undergoing a major transformation, but nobody knows how. Demolishing the old one, build new ones, but how? Nobody knows. So we invited I.M. Pei to showcase how Chinese architects supposed to build a new China. And so the government gave I.M. Pei a task. Mr. Pei, please design something modern and Chinese so we can learn. And Pei presented this image to the Chinese government, and they were very disappointed in the very beginning because they were expecting Pei to design something modern and Chinese. And this one is obviously Chinese, but not modern, right? But Pei got the Pritzker after this, yeah, because he, Philip Johnson says, okay, welcome, Mr. Pei, you are now a postmodernist. So here, Pei explained to the government, he says, okay, before you become modern, you have to be understandable that you are Chinese. So how to design a Chinese first before you become modern? Because back then, it's really a tremendous lack of confidence for ourselves. Because when we open the door, it's a colorful world outside China. And China is a black and white world. Right? So we are totally running out of confidence. And here, Pei says you have to identify your confidence again. Okay, this is a project I was engaged for 2 years when I freshly graduated from the college. And I was an on-site supervisor for this project. You can see actually the whole China architecture practice is like this after PACE showcase. Okay, something the really identifiable Chineseness. So regionalism becomes something picturesque, something iconic. You have to recognize the Chineseness, which is actually pitch roof, white wall, punctuated windows, and you know, when you see this picture, actually you don't know when this building was built or designed, right? It could be from 200 years ago, right? And this is another case in Beijing, from Beijing to actually to Huangshan, everywhere in the whole China for 2 decades, we practiced like this. And so architecture design becomes a matter of choice instead of a matter of debate. Tradition, modern, or east or west. So Chinese architecture is like this. It's a recognizable form. On one face, you see two faces. That's very scary, right? So that's the Chinese architecture in the 90s. And then those are top 10 most ugly buildings in China from the website. You can actually recognize White House, huh? Not White House, the Parliament building. This is the Chinese coins. Here is a hotel in Beijing. And then you can understand why even the China Pavilion from 2010, the World Expo, is like this. It has to be recognizable Chinese, right? 4 or 5 years ago, the APEC Conference Center is also like this, recognizable Chinese building, because it holds too much burden that you have to represent China. And then some people trained from overseas came back to China. And when they saw the situation, they said, okay, we don't want anything to do with Chinese architecture or Chinese culture or Chinese tradition. We just do modern architecture in the universal way. And when you were young, early 30s, when you got a chance to design something like 500,000 square meters, what do? It's like this, right? It's a collage of form, color, and the shapes. Overstatement is the word I used to describe the practice in the end of 1990s, because lack of confidence, right? It's supposed to be like this, but it has to look like much larger. Huh? This is Shenzhen's municipality's building. So when Kuhas came over to China, he was invited to design, to join the competition for the CCTV building. Right away, he understand China, what China needs, something larger, something stranger, something modern, you know? And he is capable of doing something less kitsch, of course. But you know this building, right? And this building, this TVCC, the CCTV. This building was the balance of this building because the cantilever of the structure. And this building was actually burned for 7 hours before it was in use. And then actually they redecorated the facade, but it's not in use anymore. They couldn't be used anymore. But they couldn't demolish the building neither, because when you demolish this building, this one will fall down. Yeah? So it become a big scandal. Very few people move into this building now. But through the collaboration between the foreign architects and the local Chinese architects, the Chinese architects learned a lot of how to do a modern building. And this is by a local Chinese architect. He won the competition, another media center in Fujian province. But when you see this image, it could be anywhere, right? In the States, in Germany, maybe not in Switzerland, too big probably. Okay, so the problem is, how should we do architecture in China? Okay, that's the big problem for me, at least. I did my PhD in Holland. I was in Holland for 8 years, and I taught in Singapore for 7 years. So I tried to find a way, so how I supposed to do practice architecture in China. And I will give two examples. Here is Singapore, because Singapore experienced similar situations, issues, and problems in China, like we are experiencing now in China. This is in Singapore. Singapore is a young country, 50 years old, when it was established in 1965. The big challenge is to define what is Singaporean, what is Singapore, because people in Singapore comes from China, from Malay, from India, from Europe. And what is Singapore? The who are Singaporeans, they have to find a way to identify themselves too. So they built, designed this thing first. So here is a legend of Singapore. So when the first Singaporean comes over to Singapore, they saw this, Marie Lang. So ever after that, we have to identify ourselves. It's like the Chinese are the song of the dragon, right? It's like the song of the Marie Lang is Singaporean, something like that. But only a legend doesn't tell the whole story. You have to build your city. How? They don't know. So what they do is they invited international architects from all over the world, Japanese, American, Europeans. So this skyline is made of international star architects, Ian Pei, Kenzo Tange, people like that. After a while, in the 80s, when the skyline is finished, and then the Singaporean coming from Malay, from the sea, suddenly when they saw the skyline, they realized, oh, this skyline is similar with Chicago, with New York, with Hong Kong. But where is Singapore? Why this is Singapore? So this question comes to every Singaporean's mind. Okay, then they start a discussion how to define Singaporean architecture. And the question actually is focused on how, what is center, what is periphery. Okay, the idea is the center has ideas. The periphery try to learn or copy the ideas from centers and try to become centers, right? But the problem is when you copy the idea from the centers, you never become center because you always copy. And you always, because you lose your own mind, you forget about your own voice, right? So idea of become center is try to do independent thinking. So this is the key to become centers. And this is a Kuhas design. Besides this one, everyone is a design of Kuhas. So for him, the idea is if reality is dirty, the architect's job is not to demolish the dirty and replace it with cleanness, but rather you make up a dialogue. Through a dialogue, you identify the uniqueness of the site. So this is what Kuhas did in Holland. Eight columns, each one is different. And this facade has nothing to do with this. And the beam is flying there like object from the sky. So for him, reality is like this. So somehow, he identified a new way of design. Okay, then Singaporean become clear. If we want to design something uniquely Singaporean, we have to understand what is the main issue in Singapore. Obviously, it's not about culture because there was no culture before in Singapore. Now, what is it? It's nature. If it's nature, what is nature about in Singapore? It's about tropicality. So living in tropicality is an issue in Singapore. Okay, then how to do buildings according to your understanding about tropicality? You have to have sun shading, right? You have to take the rain off, and you have to have cross ventilations. Simple. And then they start to design building like this. This one is Aga Khan prize winner project back to 2007, I think. You see this detail is designed to accommodate the living conditions in Singapore. In summer, especially monsoon seasons, the wind comes in, but not the rain, right? Because it comes from below. Because of this design, it got the Aga Khan. You see this now? It's different from the skyline I showed you before. It's Singaporean. So they somehow defined a contemporary lifestyle in a tropical city. It's a townhouse. It's a tropical townhouse. Very porous. Well, when you take a shower in the tropical season, raining or not raining, it doesn't make much difference, right? So why bother to have a roof? So when you think through of this issue, okay, no roof for the bathroom. It's cool. And this is a hotel, I like this hotel very much, designed by Woha. It's about tropical space. You see, when you are here in the public space in the hotel, you are totally engaged with the tropical city. Vertical green on the facade. Another example I'm going to show is Hong Kong. Okay, what is the design issue in Hong Kong? Hong Kong is about a very small footprint and you multiply, right? Maximize the efficiency use of space because they don't have land and they have big population. So you don't have land, that's why you have to build up your beach yourself. And you don't have space, it has to be multifunctional. It's like this. You have tried Chinese dim sum in Switzerland? Yes, you have, right? I think the most healthy fast food is a standardization but allow variety, yeah? And very healthy, of course. And this is Hong Kong. And I will show a case of a Hong Kongese architect. This is his home when I was born. He still lives there. His name is Gary Chang, a very good friend of mine. And this is the plan of the house, apartment, when I was born. So this is his room, his parents, two sisters, the bathroom, the kitchen, and living room. How big is this? 4 by 8 meters, 32 square meters. Tiny apartment. And 18 years later, his family moves out of the apartment. So he owned the whole apartment by himself. And he suddenly felt this is too spacious. So he actually designed a street and a square. And then later on, he felt this is not right because you can't use the same space in different functions at the same time. And then he start to think in a smarter way. Okay, here unchanged, but you can change the curtains and lighting combinations to accommodate different functions. This is how he changed. And then a few years ago, he changed again. This time is really very fundamental. You see the changes like this. Here's the last one. So it's like this shape unchanged. But inside, he told me there are 70 over ways of reconfiguring space due to different functions. Is very happy. So in both cases, in Singapore, in Hong Kong, I think the connection, there's a bridge between what the individual thinks about reality and the general issues of that particular place, right? So now we come to China. China is much larger, of course. You know, on the other side of the world, we have 1.3 billion people, and we have, I don't know how large is it, I think the whole Europe. Probably. So we don't have just one issue. We have many, many issues. So what I try to do is I go to a particular place and try to identify the issues in that particular place. I mean, the bigger picture. And then I will do a building according to my understanding about that particular place. So this is what I call reflexive regionalism. That is, has to be regional. I think every building is supposed to be regional because if we want to sustain for the 21st century, the main issue for the whole world is about sustainability. But to sustain, you have to be local because it's cheaper to build, it's more convenient as well. So how to define regional issue or regional condition, not from iconic way, But to define as a way of force is the main thing. And this is my first project after I traveled 15 years overseas and back to China. So the first project is a school for the orphanage, for the orphans. Here is the site. Okay, so what I do is I did the fundraising. I designed the thing, I find the site and built and give it back to the community. Because only that way I can have full control of the process of design, build, and give it back to the community. And here is a site I find, very poor, and very limited in terms of resource. And here is the site. In a remote, small village in Yunnan province. It's a school. So I managed to get about 300,000 renminbi, which is about 50,000 Swiss francs, to build a school of 800 square meters. It's peanuts, right? It's nothing. It's mission impossible. Okay, but I have to do it because that's the only money I have. So it has to be very simple, very straightforward, and really down to earth. And I have to use everything local. Local labor, local material, local know-how, everything. And responsive to local conditions. I will not talk about the details of the plan, but a very straightforward plan. And has to be earthquake resistant, because here is earthquake pro area. And the local people actually joined the process of construction, also learned a way of how to make the building earthquake resistant. And this is the difficult part. We can't afford to order a new steel plate. So actually we went to the junkyard, got a cheaper one, and to build this one. So local know-how as well is very largely referred here. So there's an identity of itself, but I build up kind of a dialogue between the new and the old community, and using this similar material. And the second project actually is in the same village here, but on open wilderness site. And in this case, I try to use my understanding of Chinese theory about architecture, about artificial object in relation to natural environment. And here, the mountain is a very young, energetic mountain, very powerful, very man-like mountains. And in this openness, if you want to build a little house, it's very tough and very difficult. So somehow we need to find a way to balance up with the young energy with yin energy. This is very Chinese. I think you understand what is yin or yang, right? And we actually refer to this one. If you see this picture, a very typical Chinese representation of architecture, building, landscape. If you see from perspective, you never see this, right? Only when you use the bird's eye view, you can see the relationships of the artificial and the natural one. So it's about a balance of how building engaging with landscape. So, okay. Enclosure is to provide yin energy. Water is yin energy. So the yin energy of like this is trying to balance with the yang energy of the mountain. And then what we have is like that. Okay, again, local materials, local labors. All the construction labors are from the village. And when you approach the building from here, you see the mountain, and then you see on your surface, you see this, a very low profile. The picture before is very wild in the mountain. Eh? But when you see this image, the mountain is not that wild anymore, right? Because it's balanced using the yin energy. And also refinement of the details also try to balance up the wildness of the mountain. And it's like the French dish. You use a big plate, and you present your dish. A little bit doesn't matter. This is the plate, new plate, to present the mountain. The mountain is bigger, but when you see the perspective of the mountain from here, the mountain looks different. Huh? The details are all functional. There's no decoration whatsoever. I don't like decoration. Because I think if you do decoration with a building in front of nature, it's very silly. And the third project is in Fujian province. This one, I tried to test the idea of Chinese medicine, medication theory, about how to see the human being as a totality, as a one unseparated body. And you know what, we see the human body differently, because in the Western medical science, whatever happened to your fit is something on the fit. But for us, we'll see the problems starting from probably from the circulation of your energy flow in your body. So what we do is in this case is try to rechanneling through the energy of your body, so to make your whatever part okay. So in this case, we identified a community, a very sick community, which means problems starts from before. People used to live in these two castles, and they have a public space in the center of the castle because security reasons. But later on, the issue of security is not a problem anymore. So people moved out of the castle, and they start to build the little houses surrounding the castles, and then problem starts, because if you don't use the public space here, it's not there anymore. And then they don't have a public identity of the community anymore. And it looked like this before my intervention. So my idea is to rejuvenate the community by the intervention of a multifunctional program in the center of this village, connecting the two castles. There were rivals before, like Juliet and Romeo and Juliet. They fight with each other. There was a little creek here. So my idea is to connect the two community by a bridge. And the bridge is a school also. So the young kids of seven to nine will be gathered here, because that's the most energetic body of community in this village. And we have two performance centers on both sides, and there's a little library, and there's a physical bridge as well, and the little shop underneath. So this little project will be the most public space in the whole community. So the general term of this project is connection. You see the structure is about connection. And bridge is about connection as well, both physically as well metaphysically. And if you look at the plan as well, it is about connection. So this is after it's finished. So this is the Akahan winning project. It's a playground as well for the kids. So after school, they like to hang around in this building. This is the performance stage for the puppy show. In summer, we can open up all the doors so the wind can go through. The kids are very happy. Now, the people in the village identify themselves to the bridge school, not a castle anymore, because they find this building has changed the way of life. Every day, the visitors coming from all over the place to see this building. So they build up restaurants and car parks, so every day they have visitors. And those kids actually, it's like this building opened up a window for them to see the world. Okay, another project is the video I showed before. It's a little library, again, in the countryside, and the money comes from Architecture Foundation in Hong Kong. And again, it's a poor village, so the idea is try to help the village to have different ways of economical support. And a very beautiful mountain, actually. Here is the site. I will explain why I chose the site near the water, because we don't have power supply. So this building has to live on its own. Air conditioning is on its own, no power whatsoever. And this is the material I was very impressed when I visited the village. And I was thinking maybe I should use this material somehow to help the building air conditioning itself through the use of this material. Another issue I try to tackle on is architecture in the city is too serious. I mean, too pretending to be something different. But in this case, in the village, I want to use a very simple way to do a very simple building, very down to earth, that can be maintained by the villagers themselves. And when you visit the building, you feel that it belongs to this particular place. But the knowledge of technology has to be integrated into the design, because if you want this building to be sustainable on its own, there must be something in the mind, instead of just superficially you do it, a building like that. This is supposed to provide sun shading as well as filtering of the light into the space inside. It's a library. And okay, here is the inside. So the light, the ambience of the interior space is supposed to accommodating the function of reading. And there's no furniture. You can see the in this design. Interior design, the structure, the architecture comes together as one piece. They're all totally glazed, but covered all by the twigs. And I will explain how it functions in terms of air conditioning. Can you see it? The sunshine is too reflection, huh? It's okay, huh? This is the plan. And this is, we explain how it works. So in summer, the temperature outdoor is about 30 degrees. And the temperature over the surface of the water is about 20, yeah? So the surface, the cool air can go through like this and suck in by the hot air on the top of the building through the entrance from here. Get into the space and get out from the building through the openings on the human sitting height, like this. So you feel the breeze, the cool air through your face. And we test the temperature, actually in summer, it's about 5 degrees lower than outdoor. It's the same temperature with the temperature under the tree. And in winter, it's another way around. Here is summer, the wind can go through on top as well. And in winter, it's fully closed, sealed. So the energy saved from here will evaporate into the space inside. So the temperature inside is 5 degrees higher than outside. And we didn't do anything for the material. It's totally recyclable. So in case 10 years from now, 20 years from now, this building is not in use anymore, we just burn the whole twigs and demolish everything without leaving any trees to the environment. And also we're expecting things to grow, actually already grown, and birds can find their nest as well. So the building become part of natural evolution as well, and will disappear somehow, hopefully, in the future, like this. In winter, you see the building almost disappeared. It's exactly the same color with the environment. The rocks are there before. I didn't put there. It's from the mountains. And actually, we designed a program after occupancy program so that the because we didn't have the money, the budget to buy the books. So what we do is we put a note on the website, okay, you are invited to visit the building for free, but you're welcome to donate 3 books and you can take 1 book away. In 3 months, we got a whole collection. And also through this way, people are very happy because everyone becomes the contributor for the library. And also this building becomes a platform for social exchange of ideas. And this is another project in the, it's a new extension of the Tsinghua University's Architecture School. And this one is totally different in the urban set. This is the first urban building I did, I mean, as my practice as an architect. It's a very tight space, nothing much you can do. You can only do with the maximize the efficient use of the space. Again, it's about how to maximize the space inside, but allow cross ventilation and lighting during the daytime, because the depth actually is about 22.5 meters. It's quite deep, considering it's an office building. So the central atrium space is trying to bring the lights in, as well as a cross ventilation, both for the students down here, they all use this one for the ventilation. This is the outside. Not yet. last project is the urban master plan for urban planning in Dujiangyan in South Sichuan province, and this project actually is a new one for me. It's not about architecture, but it is about how we call it urbanization, rural urbanization, and I think this is the big issue for China. And now we have about 50% of people living in the city, and 30 years ago is about 20, a little bit more than 20% of the population living in the city. And 20 years from now, we still have about 400 million people to be urbanized in the next 20 years. So it's a big thing. It's more than the population of the United States. And how to urbanize this population is very critical. And so in this case, I spent actually 3 years in trying to find a way what is the right way to do urbanization in the countryside. This is the Tongji's, I will not show this too much. This is the master plan by another school. It's about this area, how to urbanize a countryside of this size. And this master plan is to turn the whole countryside into an urban setting. And for me, I think it's totally wrong. And here's China. It's quite large, but somehow only 1/3 of the land is habitable. So 99% of population lives in this area. And also the agriculture also from this 1/3 of the land. And we have a large population. It's a true, it's a fact. You can see, huh? Okay, we used to be capable and able to accommodate our people by this, but here's the reality. Shanghai, more than 5,000 high scrapers, they're very proud to show this model of the city. And but everyone knows that the big city is very dangerous, very risky in terms of natural disaster or whatever. And this image, very interesting. Here's China. This is the population lives here, right? Here's Japan, South Korea, North Korea. And the countryside was actually abandoned. But urban living is not in good condition, neither. We used to do building like this, but now we do building like this. So what we have is a city, but not for human beings. So you have to be very creative if you want to walk on the grass in the city. And those are the points I gathered from the most habitable cities in the world. I think in Switzerland you have many of them. Human scale, regional character, non-oppressive environment, link between the past, now, and the future, sustainable social structure, easy transportation, children and elderly friendly, high green ratio, and sustainable and a balanced economical development. So to sum up, you need to have a balance between economy, society, and the environment to sustain an urban setting. Here is the photo of the reality. So we want to urbanize this one. The reason why we want to urbanize the countryside is because efficiency use of land. So you grow potato, so you sell potato. But in Holland, if you grow potato here, you probably will sell starch. So land value actually is tripled or more than that. But in China, most countryside, we didn't use the resource we have to actually deepen to add more value to the land. So this is why we want to urbanize the countryside, but we can't replace the countryside like this to the city. And so you see, in the 60s, 70s, in China, we have a big movement of sending the fresh graduates from high school to the countryside because we don't have employment in the city. And the young people are supposed to survive on their own in the countryside. But by then, we only have 20% people living in the country, in the city, and we have a big countryside to take care of the fresh graduates from the cities. But in the future, if 80% of people live in the city, we don't have countryside to go back. What happens if our economy slows down or goes down like that? Well, Singapore can buy food from anywhere. But if China wants to buy food, I think it's a disaster for the whole world, right? So we have to take care of ourselves. And if this is reality, I think what we should do is like this. Reorganize the settlements and touch, keep the total farmland untouched, but replant it. And to solve the problem of big cities like walking or not moving from one place to another place in the big cities like Miraz, it's like a maze, right? Because you never know which way to go. So it's not very efficient. And we have cloud computing now, so we can actually use the modern technology to plan our countryside in a much more efficient way. And we can do a shortcut like this. So the pattern for the city is like this. We have a central service district, and we have the villages connecting to it. And then our pattern is like this. Okay, then it's like this. So those countryside farmland is still there. But we organize them into villages. And the whole area is about 22 square kilometers. And the land value is supposed to provide a household for 30,000 people before, but now we calculate after the added land value, we could accommodate 120,000 people. So the collective housing, collective living must be the way to add up more space. It doesn't mean the living quality is lower. As long as we design as an architect in the right way, I think people would prefer to live in this kind of a countryside instead of living in the big cities, right? We'll keep some of the original huts to promote tourism. Do the research for more agriculture products, but it has to be labor intensive, so everyone must have employment. I think that's the priority. And to add up more value, to promote tourism by connecting art with land. For instance, the paddy fields if we combine different types of petty fields, we can do this. So if urbanization actually makes more carbon dioxide, right? In this case, we try to reverse the process, making more nature and less artificial to make land use more efficient. And we can see this separately. So urbanization, the rural urbanization and deurbanization will produce more oxygen and less carbon because it's more regional, yeah? So this will be the future countryside, I hope. Okay, thanks.